book. Remember, the theme of the book is joy, the joy of the Lord. And so we're just thankful for what God has taught us already out of the book, and want to learn some more today. I'm going to be reading in Philippians chapter 4 from verse 5 through verse 10. I'll be preaching verse 8 and 9 out of the book. If you'll read there as I read this. Philippians 4, 5 through 10. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Those things which ye have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do, and the God of peace shall be with you. But I rejoiced in the Lord greatly, that now at the last your care of me hath flourished again, wherein ye were also careful, but ye lacked opportunity. Bow with me for a word of prayer. Father, thank you again for being able to sing about the Lord Jesus Christ, to sing also about the fact that you've given us your holy words and preserved them so that we've got the actual account of the life of our Savior. And not only that, but all the things around it that give us the steps to live in the Christian life, to live in such a way that we portray the Lord Jesus, to live so that others can come to him the same way that we did, that by repentance and faith they can receive the mercy and the kindness and the love and the forgiveness and the justification and all of those kind of things. And so we just praise you. Lord, would you meet needs? I don't know what everybody's heart has in it today, what kinds of things might be turmoil or might be questioning, or I don't know. But Lord, every one of us have come, even those that are on the internet, they're looking for a blessing from you. And so I pray that you would do as only you can, that you'd take the very words that you've given to us for their life. Nothing else is. But thy holy word is life. And so would you please just give that in such a way through the power of the Holy Spirit today that we all would go from this place rejoicing in what you've done for us. Once again, please anoint me, for Lord, I know that it's not me and not anything I can be, but it has to be you using me as your instrument. And so we'll praise you and thank you for what you're going to do in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. This section of scripture that we've been looking at in chapter 4 keeps bringing up this idea of peace we see here. Every one of us, no doubt, wants to live in peace. I don't know about you folks, but it's hard for me to picture people living in Israel knowing that every Muslim country wants to eliminate them, push them into the Mediterranean Sea, just totally destroy that little country of Israel. And the thing that's incredible as well is more and more countries are becoming more and more Muslim. Mm-hmm. I mean, even here in the United States, we're getting to where we're starting to think like the Muslims and we're not going to help Israel anymore. Oh, God forbid that that should happen. Let's hope and pray that we can turn this country around by God's grace, by humbling ourselves and seeking his face and confessing our sin. And hopefully, you know, God will turn this country around. He'll restore the land and heal this land. Amen. We've got to, you know, but those people over there, I don't know how they lay their head on a pillow at night, you know, thinking, you know, that I'm going to put my head on the pillow and it's going to explode, you know. I mean, just incredible if you think about it. But I want us to understand that to have joy, we have to have peace. You can't have them one without the other. You got to have peace and joy, joy and peace. They go together. And that's why here in this chapter 4, we see that kind of thing going on that is here. I would say that perfect peace, and one day we're going to have that.
Amen.
Amen. Perfect peace will bring great joy. Mm-hmm. And when we think about that perfect peace down here, we can have some everlasting joy down here. Now, we've been looking at chapter 4, and we've seen here at verse number 6 that prayer brings peace. Amen? Prayer brings peace. And then we also saw here at verse number 7 that the peace of God brings peace. You know, we have to have the peace of God and peace with God and that kind of thing. That does bring about peace. You know, and make sure your sin account's short. You don't ever want to think of, you know, facing God, being in the hands of an angry God. You just don't want to be that. People that are listening by internet, if you don't know Jesus Christ as Savior, you do not want to die in your sin. You need to come to Him. How important that is. But verse 8 and verse 9 help us to understand that there are praise things and they will bring peace. Those things, I titled my message, those things, he said at verse 9, which you have both learned and received and heard and seen in me do. And so some things that we have to understand. That's what is important for us. Now, some years ago, there was a book put out, and I believe the author was Brother Tim LaHaye. It was called The Battle for Your Mind. And I want you to understand that, you know, peace has a lot to do with what's going on in our mind. You know, our mind can get all worked up, and then we're in a turmoil about whether we should and shouldn't and all that kind of thing. Now, just a few weeks ago, God allowed me the privilege, and it really is a privilege, to preach to the pastors of New York State. That's a privilege. And when I, you know, think about, you know, having to get up and hear all these men that have many, many years of experience preaching and all that, and I am going to tell them something, you know, I don't think so, you know, is what your mind says. And so mentally you can get all worked up, mentally you can get kind of nervous about the whole thing, and you know, I had to just come back to, well, God, you're in charge. You've put me here. You must have something for me to say that will be a blessing and benefit to these men. And that when I put my mind in the right perspective, then I said, okay, I can do this. Of course, it helped that I was the first one. The meeting started at 9. My wife and I got there at 10 minutes to 9. They sang one song and the pastor had me come up and preach. So I didn't have much time. It's like the time when I had a wisdom tooth that had to be pulled. The dentist said, well, you got to have that wisdom tooth pulled. I said, okay. He said, here's the instruments. Let me do it now. I said, wait a minute, doc. I got to have some time to get all nervous about this, you know. He said, no, we're doing it now. Ah, okay. But the battle for our mind, it's kind of important for us. I want to take a look here in my introduction to Proverbs chapter 23 in the first part, verse 7. Proverbs 23, just the first part of verse 7. I know the context is different, but I want you to just take a look here at Proverbs chapter 23 and the first part of verse 7. It says this, "For as he thinketh in his heart, so is he." Now, I know it goes, it's in the whole area here that, you know, people with riches and they'll sucker you in if you're not careful about it. And eat and drink, saith he to thee, but his heart is not with thee. You know, they'll get you caught into their whole, you know, things that they're doing. But just, "For as he thinketh in his heart, so is he." If that's true about that wicked man trying to entice you, that's true about everybody. As we think, isn't it interesting, in our heart, you know, our thought process moves our heart, makes us into action. So is he. So the battle, Satan's after your mind constantly, after your mind, trying to get you to be thinking about things you ought not to be thinking about. get you thinking, all these kinds of things to make you careful and all that stuff. Thinking in such a way that your peace is disrupted. So if your peace is all disrupted, how can you tell somebody else about, come to Jesus and you'll get peace, if your peace is all upset? You know, they say, I don't want what you got. I can be as upset as you are. What's the difference? Can you turn with me also to the book of Isaiah and chapter 26? Isaiah chapter 26 and verse 3. The prophet Isaiah chapter 26 and verse 3. Here's a psalm going on in the book of Isaiah, if you will, here. This was a song for them to be sung, verse 1 tells us. But verse 3 says this, Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in thee. Perfect peace, mind stayed on thee. Back here in Philippians chapter 4, we're told that we ought to think on these things. The end of verse 8, think on these things. How important. If Satan can get to your mind, if he can get to your thoughts, there goes all your peace and your joy. That's why God tells us here to think on these things. It's what we're supposed to do. So, if that's what God's Word tells us, I'm just going to emphasize that for you today. Think on these things. Now, verse 8, isn't it an incredible verse? In reality, verse 8 is a summary of the Lord Jesus Christ. Did you ever think about that? I mean, is there anyone more true than the Lord Jesus? He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Is there anyone more honest than the Lord Jesus Christ? Come unto me, and I will give thee rest. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. Amen, he said. What truth there. What is Jesus, he is just in all his dealings. He is just. He's the epitome of it. What sort of things are pure? Is there anything more pure and lovely than the Lord Jesus Christ? Amen? What sort of things are lovely? Just read the book of Song of Solomon. Over and over and over again talks about how lovely Jesus is in there. What sort of things are of a good report? Wow. What good news do we have that Jesus Christ came? The gospel. A good report, amen. Any virtue? He had all virtue. Any praise? Wow. What a description of Jesus that we have here. So, Let me take a look at these things that we're supposed to think on. Think on these things. Amen? Battle is in our mind, so think on these things. I don't understand. I've read, I've heard preached so many times, whenever we're supposed to think on these things, that we're supposed to be looking out in the world for all these things. You know, whatsoever is true. That's the first one. You know, things that are true. So number one, if you're doing an outline, number one, things that are true, you know, the world. But why would I want to go there? Why should I go there when I have 66 books that are filled with truth right here? Remember we sang, I know the Bible is true. Yeah, we sang that. You know, here's the all the truth we need to think on right here. I mean, what we think the world tells us is true many, many times is not. Yeah, the world tries to deceive us. Excuse me. Our flesh a lot of times will deceive us. I mean, come on. Have you ever thought you're getting a mosquito bite and when you look, there's nothing there? I mean, your body was screaming, something's biting, something's itching, you know, and there's nothing there. Have you ever felt hungry even though you just got through eating a meal? Hmm. You know? I mean, you know, our flesh lies to us all the time. We think it's true. Why go outside the Word of God? Amen? Can you look at some things with me? Here we go on a journey. We're going to do a journey. Let's see. Yeah, Psalm. Mm-hmm. Let's see. We're going to do here. What did I do? I goofed myself up. No, we're going to go to 1 Samuel first. Let's do it in order. Let's do the 2 Samuel. We won't do 1 Samuel. 2 Samuel. I'm sorry. I goofed myself up here. I came across a verse later that I said, wow, I really like that verse. I want to use that verse. And I have it beyond the Psalms, and it comes before the Psalms. So 2 Samuel chapter 7 and verse number 28. 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 28. It says this, "And now, O Lord God, thou art that God, and thy words be true, and thou hast promised this goodness unto thy servant. Thy words be true." I like it. I hope you do. I like it. Psalm 33 and verse number 4. Psalm 33, verse 4. Psalm 33, verse 4, God's word says, "For the word of the Lord is right, and all his works are done in truth." Then Psalm 119, verse 160, if you would. Psalm 119, verse 160. Here we read, "Thy word is true from the beginning, and every one of thy righteous judgments endureth forever." Thy word is true from the beginning. You know, think on whatsoever things are true, you know, his word. Are you ready? Can you go some more with me here? How about John chapter 17, verse 17? John's Gospel chapter 17, verse 17. "Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth." Would you go with me now to John chapter 19, verse 35? John chapter 19, verse 35. "And he that saw it bear record, and his record is true, and he knoweth that he saith true." I'm sorry, "and he knoweth that he saith true, that ye might believe." You know, here it is, the soldiers are talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. When he died on the cross, it's true, 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 true. How important that is, true. Would you go with me to 2 Thessalonians chapter number 2 and verse 13? 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse number 13. Oop. Keep going the wrong way here. Second Thessalonians 2:13 says, "But we are bound to give thanks always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth." You know, we got saved through the 2 Thessalonians 2:13. We got saved through the truth of the Word of God. Amen? That's what we got saved by. Now go to the book of Revelation. Chapter 19, please. Revelation chapter 19, verse 9. "And he saith unto me, Write, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he saith unto me, These are the true sayings of God." And then if you drop down there to verse number 11, you read, "And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war," none other than the Lord Jesus Christ. Faithful and true. Revelation chapter 21 and verse 5. Revelation 21 verse 5, "And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. And then chapter 22 and verse number 6. Chapter 22, verse number 6. And he said unto me, These sayings are faithful and true. And the Lord God of the holy prophets sent his angel to show unto his servants the things which must shortly be done. So we're told, think on whatsoever things are true. Do you need to go farther than the Word of God? I mean, do you want to really trust National Geographic that what they're saying is true? Do you want to trust what's put out in the news that it's true? You know, it might not be. Might change tomorrow. But God's Word is true, and Jesus Christ is true. He is the Word of God. True. It's so important for us. True things will be eternal with God in heaven. Do you realize that? True things will be with God eternally in heaven. If it's really true, well, is it really true that 1 + 1 = 2? Yeah. It really is. Will that be in heaven? Oh yeah, I believe it will be. Look with me in John's Gospel, chapter 6. John's Gospel, chapter 6, verse 32 and 33. John 6, 32 and 33. God's Word reads this way. Then Jesus said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, Moses gave you not that bread from heaven, but my Father giveth you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he which cometh down from heaven and giveth life unto the world. And that's the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. He is. Look at verse 63 of the same chapter. Verse 63. It is the Spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. The true words of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Look with me, please. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 18. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 18. I'm trying to establish some things here about truth. 2 Corinthians 4, 18. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. You know, some things that are true, not seen, they're eternal. And we're going to have them in heaven. Colossians chapter 3, if you would. Verse 1 through 4. Colossians chapter 3, verse 1 through 4. Colossians 3, 1 through 4, If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. You know, why look to the world for truth? Well, we've got all the truth. If you want to think on things that are true, think on things that are the Word of God. How important. But Philippians chapter 4, verse 8 then tells us to think on whatsoever things are honest. So secondly, things that are honest. Things that are honest can only be based on Scripture. How do you know anything else is honest if it isn't based on Scripture? How do you know that anything else is honest? If it's based on some man's theory, if it's based on some man's observation, it might not be true. Remember, they used to think that the world was flat and that if you sailed far enough, you'd fall off the edge of it. But the Bible said that it was round. So if people just follow the Bible, okay, that's where you get things that are honest, amen? They're based on it, you know. The search for truth based on God's Word is honest. That's what's honest. You know, conversations and dealings that are open and above board, they can be honest too. Where people have integrity and are basing what they're saying on the Word of God. How honest those can be. Well, here's a third one. We're told not only to think on things that are true and honest, whatsoever things are just. So thirdly, things that are just. Can I ask you to go with me to Psalm 9 and verse 16? Psalm number 9, verse 16, please. Things that are just. Psalm 9, verse 16. This morning, I'm sorry, it's wear out your Bible morning. Psalm 9, verse 16, it says this, "The Lord is known by the judgment which he executeth. The wicked is snared in the work of his own hands. Hegion, Selah." So we've got here that the Lord is known by the judgment with which he executeth. You want to think on things that are just? What about his judgments? Then how about Psalm 12 and verse number 6? Oh, I'm in the wrong one. I'm sorry. Psalm 10, verse 4 and 5. I'm in the wrong spot here. I've got so many of them. Psalm number 10, verse 4 and 5. "The wicked, through the pride of his countenance, will not seek after God. God is not in all his thoughts. His ways are grievous. Thy judgments are far above out of his sight. As for all his enemies, he puffeth at him." But God's judgments are right. Why does God send someone to hell? Because the wicked, through the pride of his countenance, will not seek after God. God is not in all his thoughts. That's why God's just. You know, that's why God's just. Look with me also here, if I get it right, 1 John 1:9. Amen? 1 John 1:9. "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." 1 John 1:9. Amen? He's just. And we can think on that, the justice, just like we had a message last week about the justification that God gives us. You know, we can think on that. What a thing to think about, amen? Those things are important. It's just for him to forgive us because of what Jesus Christ did when he shed his blood at Calvary's cross, amen? Now we come to this fourth one, whatsoever things are pure. So number four, things that are pure. Things that are pure. Now we go to Psalms. I'll get it right. Psalms 12 and verse number 6. This time we do Psalm 12, verse number 6. Psalm 12, verse 6 says, "The words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in the furnace of earth, purified seven times. Thou shalt keep them, O Lord, thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever." The pure words. Wow. Want to think about what things are pure? The words of God. Psalm 119 again. This time, verse 140. Psalm 119 and verse number 40. Did I say 40? I meant 140. 140. Psalm 119, 140. "Thy word is very pure, therefore thy servant loveth it." You know, I used to think, you know, if I was going to think of something pure, why don't I think about something pure white? You know, something pure white, like our garments are going to be pure white. Think about that. But down here, pure white, hard to find. Amen? Always some kind of flaw. White's a hard color to maintain, isn't it? Keep it pure. I'll never forget. I'll always remember. I better word it positive. I'll always remember I had a secretary, and she had on white that day, a summer day. She had on this beautiful white, and the copier ran out of toner, and she decided she was going to change the toner. She should have come and asked me. I don't know what happened, but when she went to do that toner, don't you know, all that black stuff went all over her white dress. Oh, I'm telling you, and it never came out. It stained it so that it never came out. It always had that gray in there. She just got rid of the thing. But I can think about the pure word of God. Amen. The pure words that God has preserved for us. They are pure. Amen. Some other things we can think about. Go with me to James chapter 1, verse 27. James chapter 1, verse 27, if you would. And here we're told something that's pure. James 1, 27, pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction, and to keep himself unspotted from the world. When I have pure religion, then don't be spotted by the world. Don't come out with the world's jokes. Don't come out with the world's lingo. No, pure, pure. I mean, see, the world pumps things at us all the time, pumps things at us all the time. You know, I mean, I'm just amazed at some of the things that people say that, you know, were so vile when I was a teenager. I mean, just, you just wouldn't ever, ever want your parents to know that you even knew what that word was. And now they just use it. Just an easy word, they just use it all the time. And I'm just amazed. Yeah. Pure religion. Keep yourself unspotted. Then also in James chapter 3 and verse 17, we read this. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. The wisdom that is from above is first pure. Want to think on something pure? How about the wisdom that's from above? Read the book of Proverbs. You get a lot of wisdom that's from above. Amen? And it's pure. It's good for us. But then we're told to think on whatsoever things are lovely. So number five, whatsoever things are lovely. I told you that there's none other than the Lord Jesus Christ that says lovely. And the Song of Solomon, so that's where I'm turning. The Song of Solomon, I'm not going to read a lot in there, just one verse. The Song of Solomon, chapter number 5 and verse 16. Remember Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, chapter 5 and verse number 16. Here it says this, his mouth is most sweet, yea, he is altogether lovely. This is my beloved and this is my friend, O daughters of Jerusalem. The Shunammite here is talking about Jesus Christ. The bride is talking about Jesus Christ. Yea, he is altogether lovely. There's no other one to think about, no other one than the Lord Jesus Christ. There are some things that that deserve love, and we ought to think about those, thinking about lovely. But the most lovely person to think on is the Lord Jesus Christ. Talk about joy and peace. Amen. When you think on him, lovely. Then it tells us, here's number six, think on things that are of a good report. That are of a good report. Well, what kinds of things are of a good report? How about the salvation of somebody? Think that's a good report? I mean, when heaven hears it, and all the angels rejoice in heaven when they hear about it. That's a good report, amen? Somebody got saved. That's a good report. We hear from the missionaries about somebody getting saved. What a good report, amen? We think on that. How about the maturing of believers? Is that a good report? When we hear that somebody gave up something that was part of the world, the flesh and the devil, they know they got rid of it out of their life. No longer do that. They see it now as wrong. They stop doing that kind of thing. Amen. That's a good thing. What good report to hear that. To hear that they keep growing in the Lord. That's a good report. Amen. we need to have those kinds of things. How about answers to prayer? Is that a good report? The other night when we heard about an answer to prayer in prayer meeting. Man, that was a good report. We all shouted. Didn't we? We all went, amen, praise God. Good report, answer to prayer. You know, those are good reports. You can think on those things. Will they give us joy and peace? They sure will. Amen. Amen, amen. And then the seventh that we're told here, and I put the two of them together, the seventh are those things that are of virtue or of praise. There be any virtue, you know, character, doing what's right all the time, whenever it's right to do it, doing right, you know, the virtue and any praise, things that we would praise people about, things that will help us grow in Jesus Christ. Those are things that are virtue and of praise, amen? Now remember, the world and the flesh and the devil will not help you grow in Jesus Christ. I'll be honest. When I sit down and watch a car race on television, that does not help me grow in Jesus Christ. Amen? That does not help me grow in Jesus Christ. But when I sit down and read my Bible, that helps me grow in Jesus Christ. Amen? When I think on these things, it helps me grow in Jesus Christ. It's an important for us. If it'll help you praise God and worship Him and glorify Him, those are things to think on. The world, the flesh, and the devil doesn't want to praise God, doesn't want to uplift Him in any way, shape, or form. So those things. We come back here to Philippians chapter number 4, and we also see verse 9. Where the Apostle Paul says, those things which ye have both learned and received and heard and seen in me do, and the God of peace shall be with you. We need to follow Paul's example. That's what we need to do. Follow his example. Don't follow my example, follow his. What things you've learned as you've read the Scripture, what things you've received as the Holy Spirit has brought those things into your heart, which things you've heard. You know, maybe somebody preached about the Apostle Paul doing this or that, the other thing, you know, that's in Scripture and brought that out to you. Whichever things you've seen, if you are doing the right things and thinking the right thoughts, God is going to give you peace. The peace of God shall be with you. That's what it says there. If we're thinking, verse 8, the right things, and if we're doing, remember verse 9 said to do whatsoever those things, If you're thinking the right thoughts and doing the right things, God's peace will be with you. So let me conclude. Here's something practical for you. Can I give you something that you can use day by day in this passage of Scripture? Get up in the morning and get out a 3x5 card and write down some things that you're going to think about that day. Maybe you have to wait while you're having devotions, and while you're having the devotions, a verse of Scripture, I'll think about that. It talked about God's faithfulness. I'll think about that. It talked about God's beauty and what heaven's going to be. I'll think about that today. You know, write down some things on a card and carry the card with you. Amen? And maybe you need to write out some verses that are going to inspire you or encourage you that day. Maybe you want to write down some hymns. You know, that hymn would be better to be going around in your mind. Yesterday, I held the door for a gal that came in. She was kind of an attractive gal. I mean, not like my wife, but kind of, you know. But she had on boots. I'm thinking in the summertime, she had big boots. So you know what started in my mind right away? That old, I don't know, was it a Jane Fonda song? These boots were made for walking, and I'm going to walk all over you. Nancy Sinatra, thank you. You know, I knew it was a, what, man, oh man. So right away, I started singing in my mind. You know, blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. I had to, you know,